Okay, so I guess it's time. I'm a bit sick, so I hope you will understand me correctly. So, first slide, who am I? So, I'm Alexandre Belloni. I'm an embedded Linux engineer at Bootlin. We are doing embedded Linux stuff, mostly development, consulting, a bit of training. And we have a strong open source focus, right? So I'm a contributor. I'm the maintainer for the Linux kernel RTC subsystem. So that's why this talk is there. And I'm also co-maintaining support for the microchip ARM SoCs. So previously they were Atmel, now they are microchip. And I'm also maintaining the microchip MIPS SoCs now. So the RTC subsystem, it was introduced in 2.6.17. So it's actually pretty recent, I would say, because all the history is in Git, right? So there is, if you want to see the whole development history of it, it's in Git, so it's pretty convenient. I took over the maintenance in 4.1, so it was in April 2015. And just for some information, just historic information. So basically, the mailing list was on Google groups until Google decided it was sending a lot of spam. Actually, it still receives like, I don't know, 300 job offers per day or so. So yeah, it was sending a lot of spam. So now it's on Voyager on kernel.org. It has been created just after that. The archives are now also on Lore, which is pretty nice because it's a public inbox. So if you want to get all the archives from the beginning, so you will get them. I'm using Patchwork. This is something I did. Basically, Patchwork was kind of left as is. It had like 3,600 patches to review. I did most of the work, and now I'm at about 20, something like that. So that's nice. The Git repository is on kernel.org if you are looking for the latest code, so it's there. Some statistics, just to show you if it's still lively, right? So those are the mailing list statistics since I took the project, right? So this is a number of mails I'm kind of reading. And the commit statistics. So those are the statistics since the beginning of the RTC subsystem. You will see some spikes. So there is a spike in 3.10 and another one in 3.11. Those were the conversions to the DevmManage registration for the RTC. So we had one patch per driver, which is kind of a lot. So the recent changes, so why do we have so many commits and so many mails? It's because basically every vendor just decided that their own IP will be better than the other one. So we have many, many drivers, and so since 4.0, I have all those drivers that are brand new, and some other ones that just took, that are compatible with new IPs. So, you will say, okay, an RTC is quite simple, right? It just gives the date and the time. But basically, every vendor decides that it does that better than the other ones. So, recent changes. The RTC is not, one RTC is not exactly just giving the time, right? You also want that time to be precise enough. And what you will get is that you have a crystal that is either external or in package of the RTC, and it's usually running at 32 kilohertz. And because of manufacturing process, or even because of the temperature, or simply aging of the quartz inside the crystal, you will find variance in the exact frequency. So you want to be able to change or to tune that frequency. So some RTCs will provide you with some registers to control correction pulses. So basically what they do is that they will add or subtract pulses from time to time in a second. And so that second will be slightly longer or slightly smaller, right? So we have a CSFS interface for that now. It's named, it's an offset file that is in the RTC folder. And the unit of that file is in part per billion. And a positive value will add a pulse, right? So positive values add pulses, which means that it makes the day longer, right? And negative values will make the day smaller. The name that we chose, I kind of chose it, but yeah. The name is coming from the NXP datasheets. NXP is making many RTCs, and even their IPs are used inside other RTCs. So I took the name from them. You will find some other vendors calling that digital trimming, something I didn't know at the beginning. And now you also have the other part of it, so that will be analog trimming. So that's another way to try to tune a crystal. It will be to change the load capacitance. So basically you have a capacitor that is on the X1, X2 pins of the RTC, and some RTCs are able to actually change it. So you usually have like, I don't know, like 3 or 4 values that you can put there. Some RTCs are quite more complex than that. And because it changed quite drastically, the actual speed of the crystal, it is a device tree property, because it actually depends on what kind of crystal you are putting there. So the device tree property is quartz load femtofarad, so it's in femtofarad. Why? Because we have RTCs that are using picofarads, but it's a floating point in picofarads, so we had to go to femtofarad. Also, some other change, it's the non-volatile memory, so that's what you will have. Some RTCs, actually many RTCs will have a small amount of RAM. Sometimes it's only 1 bit, which is not much. Sometimes you will get to almost 1 meg, so it's not bad. And because the RTC is always on, it's always powered, right? Even if your system is shut down, you will always get some voltage on your RTC, else you will basically just lose the time. So what is the use of that RTC? So basically, because it's always on, the RAM is non-volatile. And that memory is now exposed using the NVMEM framework, so NVMEM for non-volatile memory, which is something really nice, because you can now access it through user space, but also from kernel space. So if you store something that you need in the kernel, you can still retrieve data from there. It was not possible before. So I added a new function to register memory in the NVMEM framework. So you just pass an RTC device and an NVMEM config, and then the RTC subsystem will take care of registering the NVMEM device at the correct place. it was not the case at the beginning, but now multiple calls are also allowed for that. So sometimes you will have multiple RAM banks, or you may have EEPROM and RAM on the same RTC, so they can both be exposed through the same, through NVMEM. You also have something, so you have the NVRAM old API. We had to do that because some drivers already had support for that particular, to read and write to that particular RAM. Unfortunately, it was only done from user space, and they basically just added a CSFS file and using that. So because this is part of the ABI, user space ABI, it was not removed. But if you use it now, you will get a deprecation warning. So I still didn't decide when I will want to actually remove it. I will try to do that just after an LTS, but yeah, I don't know. So I also changed the RTC registration. So basically, before you had DevM RTC device register, and it was actually difficult to use because it was allocating the RTC device structure and registering it at the same time. So if you needed to do something with the struct RTC device, then you would already have the RTC registered at the time you allocated it. So now I split that registration into two parts. The first one is allocating it, so that's the one that is DVM managed, right? So DVM RTC allocate device. And then the other one will just register the RTC device itself in the framework. Right? So that really allows you to handle the strict RTC device. We will see why just later, why it's important. But it also allows to remove a lot of REST conditions in the drivers, because for example, if you are adding, well, if you are requesting an interrupt, and that interrupt, the interrupt handler will probably need the RTC device, right? So if you actually register the interrupt before calling DevM RTC device register, then you may just dereference null. So that could happen. It actually happened on a few platforms. So those REST conditions are not solved. So that's good. Also note that there is no non-DevM managed registration anymore. So I just removed all of it. If it's necessary, I will just add it back. But I don't think it's necessary for a driver to be able to manage the life cycle of an RTC device. So one change that was done just after that was the CCFS attribute registration, and that's where it's important to be able to allocate and register the device separately. So before, you had the CCFS attributes that were created just after registration, and that actually opens up a REST condition where the CCFS RTC folder will appear. And then later you will have all the elements, all the other attributes appearing inside. And so if your user space is monitoring for that particular RTC folder, it may decide that the attributes are not there because they are not there at the beginning. So Greg Hartman already wrote a blog post a while ago about that. So it's a pretty well-known REST condition. So we don't have it now because basically what we do is allocating the RTC device and then just use RTC add group and or RTC add groups, and that will add CCFS attributes to your RTC, and so all the attributes will appear just as at the same time. So one of the important change also is the RTC range. So there are two new members inside. So it's range min and range max. Range max is a time U64, and range min is a time 6040. So this allows the driver to actually declare the time and date and time range that is supported by the RTC hardware, which is pretty nice because now the core will be able to just a check that that whatever is coming from user space will fit inside that range. There is something that is really important is that no discontinuity is allowed in that range, which means that the time in the range has to be continuous. It's quite important because, for example, you will find some RTCs that will just say, okay, I can basically support everything up to 9,999, but it's actually not the case because, for example, on the centuries, they will not properly handle the leap years, right? And once you have that kind of discontinuity, so basically you never know if you are just before or if you are after, or if you are after and you already corrected that discontinuity or not. So it's really important that the time has to be just continuous in that range. So something else, it's the RTC offset. So in retrospect, I think I should have called that another way. So, but it's not exposed as is to user space, so I can still rename it. So I will probably do that at some point. So we probably we just have an issue for the RTC end of time. So when the RTC will not be able to continue, let's say after 2106, for example, we want to be able to just add or subtract an offset before calling the driver callback. So that's something the core is doing. And it's only able to do that, obviously, if it knows the available range of the RTC, right? So the drivers that are supporting that right now are the ones that are setting range min and range max. Just note that we don't really have the issue in 2038, because we are never using a time T in the RTC subsystem. So it's always unsigned. So basically, there are almost no RTCs that will fail in 2038 at the end of the Unix epoch on 32 bits, right? Because it's actually 31 bits. So the most common failing date will be 2100, and then it's followed by 2106, just because that's when the 32-bit unsigned will overflow. So why it was important to do that? It's mainly because it's mandatory for Android devices to be able to set the RTC to something before 2000. I didn't know that. I don't know. I mean, I've asked, I never had the answer, and basically people were not really happy, but yeah. Basically they want to be able to set to the 1970, right? So if your device is not set, it has to be set to 1970, right? But well. So we have a device tree property to change then the offset. It's called start year. It's basically the beginning year that you want. So time zero for that RTC will start at that year. So for example, in that case, if you have an RTC that does 2000 to 2100, then you do start year is 1970, and then the whole range will be shifted. So it will do 1970 to 2069, right? So there are also some other improvements. So we have a new printk format, which is nice. So it's a PTR, capital R. So that one, you just pass an RTCTM, so that's the broken out date and time, and it will just print all the members of that structure, which is really nice instead of doing %d, 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 and all the structure, the reference. So that's really useful. We also have trace points at interesting functions, so when you set the time, when you read the time, when you have an alarm and that kind of thing, that allows you to actually debug your driver without even adding debug inside, which is really nice. We also have the time T overflow, so that one will be the signed 32-bit, that is now properly handled in RTC HC26, so that's basically what is reading the RTC when Linux is booting and setting the system time with that. The fact is that it didn't care that the user space was 32-bit only, and it could set a time that was later than 2038, which will just basically break systemd. it's not really systemd's fault, but it will break and systemd will just start looping because the kernel will say, hey, your timer has expired and your timer has expired and your timer has expired, and it will just, so that's fixed now. And we had a few, before that we had a few drivers handling that on their own pretty poorly, so yeah, now it's not doing that anymore. I also did some a new tool, so that's RTC range. That one will test the continuous range of an RTC. So it's not really testing all the dates, obviously, but there is a set of cutoff dates that are usually problematic for RTCs, and it will test those, right? So, and it will say, okay, that RTC looks like it will fail at that time. Another improvement that we have is timestamping. I have more on that later. Basically, timestamping is a quite interesting feature of an RTC. It's just that your RTC will be able to remember the time when it has seen an event. The event can be whatever. Usually what you get is that you will get a few GPIOs on your RTC, and you will just connect something there just to detect, for example, tampering or that kind of stuff. That's what you get, for example, just to know if someone opens a case of whatever product you are doing or that kind of stuff. So, and it will even remember at what time it happened, right? So you can also say, okay, I want the first occurrence of the event or the last one, and that kind of thing. So we have support for timestamping now. And we also have support for trickle charging, which is, which was not straightforward at first. So trickle charging is basically when you have a battery and it's a chargeable battery, and you are just sending a really small current there to keep the battery topped up. And you have to configure it depending on your battery physical attributes, right? You don't want to overcharge it, and you probably don't want to undercharge it, else you will not remember the date and time at some point. I did also some cleanup. There were many RTC valid TM calls that were unnecessary. So basically, drivers were looking at the validity of the date and time that the RTC was returning, and it was also looking at the validity of date and time that was coming from user space. But basically, just the RTC core is already doing that. So it's not necessary to do that in a driver. So I went and I removed all those unnecessary calls, so people copy-pasting code from other drivers will not make the same mistake again. I also remove many members of the struct class ops. So the struct RTC class ops, it's basically the set of callbacks from your driver. So that's where you will define your read time, set time, read alarm, and set alarms callbacks, for example. And many of those were not necessary anymore. So I removed the open and release, because basically what, nobody was using open, and what was done in release didn't make sense. So I just removed the three or four users of the release callback. And then we have set MMSS and set MMSS 64. I removed those simply by replacing them by set time, which was quite straightforward. And then we have a read callback that was basically not used anymore, so it also has been removed. Some people also tried to constify the RTC class ops inside the driver, so it's pretty important because those are callbacks. So if an attacker ever had control over that structure, it could have been using that as a jump point to whatever payload of the attack. So that's good. it was not always possible to do so, and I will talk about that just a bit later. The RTC control API also has been removed. Basically, it had only one user. It was ASOC, And ASIC was not using that since ages, so I just removed. It was already replaced by HR Timer in 2006. So, well, I didn't even have to write a replacement for it. There is also the RTC IRQ register that was not used. It's basically, it was the in-kernel IRQ user or consumer of the alarms for an RTC, and nobody's actually using that, mainly because now we are also using timers inside the RTC core before setting the alarm. So we always know when an alarm just happened. And I also recently renamed the core files. So now in drivers RTCs, you will get all the RTC drivers starting with RTC, and all the core files will not start with RTC. Right. So future changes, that's what needs to happen soon, because there are many people waiting for those features. So the first one is voltage detection. We kind of have already something to detect voltage drop. Unfortunately, it was an I/O control. That's quite simple. It's not even documented. It basically returns one integer. So it's RTC VL read. But the fact is that RTCs quite often have different types of monitored voltage. So usually what you will get is the main one will be the auxiliary supply. That's the one that will be monitored because it's your battery and you want to know when you have to change it. But they may also monitor the main supply, and so that you will know when it is switching from the main supply to the auxiliary supply or battery supply. And quite often you will also have multiple states for that. So which means, okay, the battery is okay, the battery is low, please change it, or the battery is low and I'm starting to remove functionalities. And what kind of functionalities you will lose is, for example, the temperature compensation of your crystal, right? Some RTCs will have that enabled by default, and which is nice because then you don't have to care about the offset. You remember of the digital trimming of your crystal, because the RTC will do it for you depending on the temperature it measures. But if the battery is too low, then you will start losing that functionality. And so while you will not lose the time, it will get less precise. and the last stage is basically data is lost, the voltage is too low, and I can't work anymore. So my idea is to actually have a new I/O control to manage that. And I'm still not decided on the exact structure that I will have to pass, because I want to be able to be flexible enough to support all the RTCs that are handling multiple voltages, because I found an RTC that had three different voltages it can monitor, so I need to also be able to support that. So there are also some changes to timestamping. So timestamping, I already described that. The fact is that right now it's exposed through a CSFS file, which is quite okay, because that CSFS file can block on read, which then you just say, okay, you have a user space program that will try to read that timestamp. So timestamp 0, timestamp 1, or timestamp 2 file. And it will block until the event happens, which is nice. But I'm thinking maybe we need a new I/O control, because we also need to be able to configure what kind of timestamp you want, whether you want to keep only the first event or if you want also the last event. For some of the RTCs, you have three different timestamps, and you have two different input pins. So that gives you four different configuration for only three timestamps. So you actually have to be able to configure what kind of timestamp you want to keep, whether you want the first event or the last event of that pin or the other pin. It is also currently open-coded in each driver that supports that feature, so there is room for factorization in the core because there is no point in letting the drivers all just define their own functions to do that. So I'm still not quite sure. We already have a solution, so I'm still not quite sure what I will do with that, but it's not that urgent. The voltage detection is way more urgent than that because people are waiting for me to do something. And there is also another change that is quite urgent right now. It's the backup switch mode. Basically, it's possible for some RTCs to select the backup switch policy. So basically, that means that when do you want to switch to your auxiliary power source, right? So the common policies will be disabled. Okay, I don't have any other power source, so I don't want to ever switch. And why would you do that? It's actually important to be able to disable it because the backup switch detection is actually consuming a bit of power. So if your main source is already a battery, you probably don't want you want to disable it to save a bit of power. Then you also have the direct policy, which means, okay, as soon as my main power supply drops below my auxiliary supply, I want to switch to my auxiliary supply. You also have standby, that is kind of, well, it's only used by one RTC, but it's there. And the last one is level. So basically, when my main power supply drops below a certain level, I will want to switch to my auxiliary supply, which is a bit different from direct. So this will be implemented through a device tree property. We already discussed that with Rob, so that's probably fine. The main issue I had is that I needed to find meaningful values for all those policies, and I need to kind of find the common policies that are available so that, well, it's not too specific to one particular device and will be able to be reused across all the devices that we support. Right. So, there is also one point that is that it is necessary to actually avoid hard-coding that kind of policy into the driver because the RTC is always on again, so it may have been already configured by someone else, right? And if you actually hard-code that into the driver, you may break someone else's platform because they already specifically configured their RTC to work that way, and then you are doing something else and you break some platforms. So I know that I have two patches to review, and that's exactly what they do. So yeah, that's why it's not there yet, but it's quite urgent to work on that. There is also some alarm handling things I need to take care of, or someone needs to take care of. So there is the alarm support detection. Right now, you have many drivers that will just modify the struct RTC ops when alarms are not present. And this prevents quantification, right? So inside your drivers, you probably want to quantify. You remember that that structure because it's using callbacks. And some drivers are actually modifying it, so you can't quantify it there. So this is quite some work to do because probably the way forward is just to have some flags in the RTC device struct saying, okay, that RTC supports alarms or doesn't support alarms. And it may support alarms, well, the drivers may support alarms, but the RTC integration may not support alarm. For example, if the alarm pin is not connected to any interrupt, then you will not be able to handle the alarms. We also have something else with alarms, is that some RTCs only have a minute granularity on the alarm, so which means that it has to be, well, there is no seconds register for the alarm. Currently, it's open coded in each driver that will just run down or run up the alarm, which is not nice because they are not all behaving the same way, and we probably want to have a common way of handling that. And well, it's also good to factorize that kind of code. And the same for wake-up support. there are actually many parameters to take into account when decided whether an RTC is able to wake up the platform. One of them is, for example, if you have an interrupt, you are probably already able to wake up, but then you will have to ensure that this interrupt you can actually request it. But you may also have some platforms with the alarm pin not connected to the CPU, but for example to a PMIC, and in that case the RTC is still able to wake up the system, right? Just that it just means that your CPU will never be aware of it, right? But the PMIC will see the signal. So everything there is already working, but all the drivers are currently open coding that kind of things, and it's probably worth having it just at one place. I know that for the I2C RTCs, it's already handled by the I2C subsystem. So it's mainly an issue for the SPI RTCs. And then the last one, it's alarm routing. So I only saw one patch trying to do that, and we couldn't agree to the correct device tree properties yet. So basically what we have is that some RTCs have multiple interrupt pins, so those are interrupt outputs, right? And they can configure which interrupt goes to which pin. It's not that useful if your interrupt is just basically going to your CPU, because, well, it doesn't matter if you have multiple interrupts or only one. You probably will have only one interrupt handler anyway. So, but it's useful if you have an interrupt for the CPU and then an interrupt for the PMIC, for example. Something else I need to work on, or someone needs to work on, is that many RTCs are storing the time and date in BCD format, so the BCD encoding. And basically, there is good potential for code factorization there, especially when the driver is using RegMap to access the RTC registers. Then it's quite easy to actually say, oh, okay, I want just one function to read the time and date from that BCD RTC, because they are all using the same layout for the date and time, and it's probably, well, it's something I have in the back of my mind. I never actually really worked on it. And I also need to do something about drivers that are not RTCs, timers that are not RTCs, because we now have some platform timers that are able to wake up the platform. And they don't actually handle the system time for multiple different reasons. Sometimes because the counter is too small, or it will be counting downward, or maybe you are not even able to read that counter, right? So the driver currently open code the dummy read time and set time to make the RTC core happy, so it will be able to set the alarm, and then you will be able to set your timer and say, okay, I need that timer to fire at that time. But yeah, well, and it will just wake up the platform. So there is also potential for factorization there. There are only two drivers right now doing that, so it's not that urgent, but at some point in time, I will probably need to have something for that. So I will soon finish with that. So I need to revisit two different I/O controls. There is epoch read and epoch set. to change the RTC offset. So right now it's already changing the RTC offset, but there is only one platform doing that. I think it's Alpha. But that will allow changing the RTC offset at runtime instead of relying on a device tree property, which will be much better, because then your user space will be able to do that properly and say, okay, I need to read the RTC time, change the RTC epoch, and then set the RTC time again. So yeah, that's something that needs to be done. I definitely need to write documentation on how to write an RTC driver and avoid the common pitfalls, because I kind of repeat myself every time I see a new driver, which is not good. Most of the issue I see is because people never realize that they must not initialize the RTC in the prop function, right? You must only initialize the RTC when you are sure that it is in a power on condition, meaning that it lost power just before and it's now ready to be initialized. Because if you reinitialize it every time, you may lose some data or whatever, right? People never realize that the RTC is always on, basically. And the last point is basically splitting up the DS1307 Franken driver, I call it. It will come after the BCD things, because it's basically people saying, okay, all the BCD RTCs are using the same layout, and so they just add whatever new RTC inside that driver, which is, I mean, it's okay, but that driver is starting to be too big to be maintainable. And I really want to split it up just so that it's easier to review and less easy to break other RTCs when changing only one specific RTC. And I think that was it. I was a bit long, right? So any question? Yes, you have a question. I don't know if it works.
So somewhere at the beginning, you have a device tree property, which allows you to change the beginning of the RTC.
Yes, the epoch.
Year. Yep. Don't you think that's encoding policy into the device tree instead of describing hardware?
Yeah, well, it's.
I mean, you're the start here. You're not supposed to encode policy into device tree, I believe.
Yeah, it's not actually. The reasoning behind that is that it's not actually really policy. It just means that all your device, it's kind of related to your hardware. But yeah, I mean, I understand what you say, but it's not really configuration. It's something that you need to know. Okay, that RTC starts at that time, just so that you can actually read the time properly. If you never encode that, then you never know what kind of time you have in your RTC. So it's not really policy. It's also hardware dependent. It's hardware dependent in the sense that if you have an RTC that is going only from 2000 to 2100 or so, and you want your range to be from 1970, then, you have to use that and say, okay, my device is starting at 1970.
But then it's a policy.
Well, it has been reviewed and accepted. But I kind of agree that it's not the best solution to that.
Basically, the reason for device tree to only describe hardware is so you can boot another OS and it uses the same device tree.
Yes.
Well, if you boot another OS, it should use the same time for the RTC.
Yes.
Otherwise, it's going to have a different interpretation of the RTC. It's like GPIO hogging. This thing actually has that function, so you can't use it any other way. Where else are you going to put it? In BIOS?
Yeah. there is kind of no place to encode that, and that's where you see that you have the issue in x86 with the local time versus UTC time, right? And because nobody is actually saying, okay, the RTC is in UTC or in local time, then you are kind of screwed, so.
So looking into that, the RTCs usually handle like leap days and all that stuff. Does that work with that property, start year? So if I set like an arbitrary start year there, how will that handle like leap years and leap seconds?
Yeah, okay. Leap years are properly handled by that. You don't really care. What we do is basically we know what is the offset in seconds from epoch for the start year versus the start of the RTC. And we just do the conversion to time, which means that we, at that point, we don't care about leap years anymore, because we know okay, we have an amount of seconds from whatever is the start of the time for that RTC. That idea is actually coming from one RTC that was thinking there was 31 days in November. So, yeah, basically that RTC is kind of useless. But yeah, that's what we did there. It just, we said, oh, okay, even if it is a time stored in BCD, which we will just consider the amount of seconds since a particular epoch and just say, okay, that's how it's working. So it requires to do some conversion, so it's less efficient, but well, it's working well. Any other question? Thank you.